sure they stay awake.
Someone's got it.
That's right. No, he's real good at it. I'm
getting
the back two rows.
If I had known that all it took to get this many people here was to start a new congregation, we would have done it earlier. So I just want to welcome all of you and thank all of you for coming. There's another chair up here, another one here. You can just kind of fill in at the tables. I'm really grateful because I know all of you had at least one other thing that you could have been doing tonight in your family, and other people in your family probably are doing those things. So thank you for coming. I'd like to start with prayer and a little scripture. Our scripture for this weekend, interestingly enough, is Philippians 4, and it's just a few verses. And it goes like this: rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to all. The Lord is near. Do not worry about anything, but in everything, in prayer and supplication, make your requests known to God. And the God of peace, which passes all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Doesn't that just all make us feel a little bit better? How many times have you spoken that scripture? And I'll start with a prayer from evening prayer. Oh God, you have called your servants to ventures of which we cannot see the ending, by paths as yet untrodden, through perils unknown. Give us faith to go out with good courage, not knowing where we go, but only that your hand is leading us and your love supporting us through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. I think that's so interesting that it's an evening prayer. So just before you go to bed, you're thinking about where God may lead you the next day. It's actually kind of a Jewish concept, is that your day doesn't begin in the morning, but it begins when you go to bed the night before. So it's kind of interesting, but also it gives us the assurance that we're not going to know all the answers to everything, but we know who is leading us and guiding us through this process. I just want to extend a welcome to Pastor Hector Garfias. He's from our Synod office. He's the... Director of Evangelical Mission, so you'll hear his name a little bit later, spoken with love, as we went through this process. So our focus tonight, we're going to answer the questions of the why questions. Why Geneva Lutheran? Why this particular mission? Excuse me. Oh, it's Stephanie Ortigal. She's on her way.
Let's answer her on speaker.
It was a text. Yeah. Stephanie, would you like to be here? Anyway, we're going to answer why GLC, why this particular mission, and why now. But I want to make clear from the very beginning that this is not a done deal. This is one more step, and this is obviously a very public step in the process when we're going to begin a process of diligence. So we're going to answer those questions, then we're going to give you a chance at your tables to write down all kinds of questions that have been swirling around in your heads. Then Craig Dessens is going to tell you how the phases are going to unfold and where your questions might be answered in those phases. So, does that make sense? So, we're probably not going to answer all your questions. So, let's start with why GLC. One of the things I've been saying is that it is part of the history of our congregation, because every congregation in the Valley in some way, shape, or form came from this congregation. Because when did it form? 1853. The train line came up here and stopped in Geneva in 1848. And it took until 2006 to get the rest of the way back. But if you look at where ELCA congregations are, as you come out Route 38, there's many, many ELCA congregations within just a few blocks of this very same train line. So it's kind of an artery that comes out. But most of our planting, of course, went north and south as Swedes. Pastor Schrock from Bethany will say that they couldn't all get along, but I like to frame it more positively. Every town needed their own church for all kinds of reasons. So we've been part of that, but there's another part that I haven't talked about, and that's when they chose to build this congregation here. They had a building over at 4th and State, and John Anderson will correct me if I'm wrong.
I will.
Yes,
you will. You're never wrong.
But they chose to buy land here rather than get free land out on Caneville Road.
Yes.
So we could have been in the lineup with St. Peter's and Faith Lutheran. Does anyone think it would be the same congregation if it was out there?
No.
We'd have a whole lot more parking, though, I can tell you.
Yeah.
But it wouldn't be the same. But what happened when they built it here, and this is part of the historical understanding of this congregation, is there's an upper limit. This congregation can't grow and grow and grow and grow and grow to be 1,000 members because there's not parking, there's not space, there's nowhere else to build. But it keeps the congregation at a size that's pretty nimble and able to move on things. But I think that that's part of our history as well, is it was never about being the biggest church, it was about staying in a format that was missional. So it's part of our history. But of course, it's also part of Christ's call for us. And the place where I find this is in the parable of the talents in the book of Matthew. I don't think I've preached on it for about 5 years, but it was absolutely life-changing in the way I understood stewardship and giving and the things that I had. Little summary, there's a landowner, an owner, a wealthier man who's going to go away, and he entrusts to his servants his property, talents. To one he gives 5, to another he gives 2, to another he gives 1. The one with 5, what does he do? Doubles it. The one with 2, doubles it. The one with 1, digs a hole and buries it. The guy comes back and he says, okay, what'd you do? The one with 5 says, I made 10. Well done. The one with 2 says, I made 4. Well done. The one with 1 says, I knew you were cruel. I knew you took things that weren't yours, so I dug a hole and buried it because at least I could give you back what was yours. Jesus says, to those who have, more will be given, and to those who do not have, even what they have will be taken away, which sounds kind of like a jerky thing to say. Except, who in the parable got nothing? No one. Everyone had something. What was the difference between the one with 5 and the one with 2 and the one with 1? The one with 1 didn't see that he had something. And we can all tell stories anecdotally of people that sure look like they don't have very much that are able to do pretty amazing things with them. It's not about what you have, it's about what you do with it. It's about participating in God's life and the things that God is doing in the world. So how many talents do you think our congregation has? It's kind of a trick question. I mean, I would say yes, we have a lot, right? We've been entrusted, a lot has been entrusted to our care. But it doesn't matter how much you have. However much you have, you're supposed to be releasing it always for God's purposes. That's why we talk about money and the budget the way that we do. What do we say? It's never going to be a crisis. We're never going to run around panicking. We're going to say, this is what God has given us to work with. And shame on us if we can't figure out a way to work with whatever that amount is, right? Doesn't matter how much it is. So it's our history. It's part of Christ's call for us. It's also part of our present. I wasn't expecting, I forget that I actually have to hold the microphone. Which, as you know, I like to move.
So she's got to talk.
So it becomes kind of problematic for me. This is my whiteboards, right? My team is coming to untangle. What? Did you all see how hard it is to move these whiteboards? All right, there's a, you could say that every church, thank you very much, every church, it's Christ's call to do this, right? So why us? That's not answering the question, right? Well, there's an arc of church life. Have any of you seen this? And they say that, you know, it's kind of grow, 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 plateau, die, die, die. But at different points, congregations can kind of re-enter a different phase of life. Sometimes a crisis will cause this, and depending on where it is, it's called different things. But I don't like to think so much about this as being life and this as being death. I like to think that over here is missional congregations. So congregations that look at what they have, congregations that are looking outward, congregations that are participating with the talents that they've been given, however many those are. So I believe there are congregations that can close their doors, that are doing it in a missional way. Over here, I think these congregations engage in magical thinking. So they focus on what they don't have, and they think that if they could just get the right magical thing, that all their problems would be solved. right? So it's more of an internal focus. So which side would you say our congregation is on? Yeah, we're on the missional side, and I think we're getting here. And you know, you might think that where you want to go is up here and like live up here and it's awesome up there. But I kind of believe that that's where churches start to die. They just don't realize it until they get down here. But over here, you always should have something to do if you're always paying attention for what God is doing, because I don't think God ever takes a break. Missional congregations, people are less likely to get burned out because it's more exciting, there's more energy, and there should be more people coming in. In magical thinking congregations, they get exhausted. And almost anything you can do can be either missional or magical, just depending on how you frame it. Buildings can be missional or magical. Congregations that say, how can we use our building more? You can see how well used our building is, right? 7 days a week. Magical thinking thinks, if we could just do the right things to our building, people would come here. Missional thinking, when you're calling a pastor, this congregation, it said in the paperwork, we're doing these things and we're looking for a pastor to come and join us and then take us to the next place where God is calling us to be. Magical thinking congregations say, when our pastor comes, they'll attract all the young families with children, they'll invite back all the people that left. And you know what, that was my first call, and I actually thought I could do it. I was either that arrogant or that stupid, one or the other. So congregations that are on the side are going to be the ones that are shooting off. And so if that's the zone that we're in, and I believe that we are, you never quite get done with stuff. You never have it all together enough that you're always working on things. But this is also the place where congregations are most likely to see, oh, there's more work to be done, and they're more likely to launch missions. The final thing that I want to talk about in this part about why GLC is we did a congregational assessment a couple of years ago. Do some of you remember that? A whole lot of you weren't here a couple of years ago. That's kind of interesting, right? We did a congregational assessment, and what that little drawing shows is we were up in the transformational quadrant, high energy and high satisfaction. And I think it was something like 20% of the congregations are in that zone. But we didn't put up a poster that said, we're transformational. We said, we gotta keep working. Like, we're being challenged. We've gotten some talents, and we need to do something with that. So out of that came our vision, mission, strategic goals. So the generous life in Christ, that's when we started talking about that. The mission that we step into, the story of God's generosity, never more clearly revealed than in Jesus. We do that every week, and then we're sent out into the world. And that's where it intersects with this idea of going to Elburn, is that's part of the world that we serve. In fact, we actually have people from Elburn here, right? Give a holler, Elburn folks. So it's part of a mission field as well. Another thing, though, that happened in that, so that's our present, is we're in this transformational zone, we're in this missional zone, but we did a planning for generosity. We pulled together a team of people, and some of those people are here. Bob Zimmerman was on that team, Craig Mickelson was on that team, Stu Gergens was on that team, and what they did was they were supposed to balance the fact that we have a mortgage that needs to be refinanced by 2020. We have a lot of projects that need to be done in the church, and we have this call to do mission. So how are we going to balance those things without just doing constant capital campaigns? Anyone up for that? Sign me up. So they came back with a plan, and that plan is something that we're going to be voting on June 3rd, which is what? To refinance the mortgage at a lower rate, extend the amortization, and get the projects done. That was in order to free up money and energy mission so that when we were ready to do it. But do you remember what the time frame was on the mission at that point?
3 to 5 years.
And this was a year ago when they gave the report. So we're in 2 to 4 years right now. So that was the plan. So it's also been part of our future planning. So why GLC? It's part of our history. It's Christ's call for all Christians, but that we're in a unique position in our present. We've been planning for this. We didn't think it would happen quite this early, and I'll talk frankly about that in a few minutes. But it's here, and we have an opportunity. So why this particular mission? Has anyone driven out to Elburn lately? Yeah. Those of you who live in Elburn are like, yes. Anyone been to Reams? Yes. Okay. So what's happening in Elburn if you drive out Kesslinger? Yeah. There's houses being built on both sides, north and south of Kesslinger. And also, those of you who are from Elburn, the options for worship in Elburn are a pretty narrow theological span. There's a Catholic church, and then there's several more non-denominational kind of churches, right, but very small. So there's really nothing exactly like the ELCA out there. So you all agree that you can see that something's happening in Elburn. Okay. But how do we do mission? Used to be, and you can refer to your sheet as it's helpful, but it used to be that they parachute a pastor into a cornfield. Although that sounds kind of exciting. Merle would totally do that. Jump out of a plane, I'm in. And they give them 3 years to be self-sustaining. Right, this is true. 3 years, self-sustaining. A couple problems with that, it stopped working very well. The bishop, I was at a meeting there yesterday, and he said something like 85% of new starts in the ELCA fail. What, 85? It's a lot. Yeah, it's a big number of them fail. Wait, I shouldn't have said that right now. I'm going to tell you why ours won't.
Well, you could change that.
Well, and that's what I'm going to say. In our synod, we do things differently. And I don't know if other synods do it differently. This is the only synod I've ever been in. But probably about 8 or 9 years ago, Bishop Miller said, we're going to do mission differently. Because there was another problem with that model, is that there are certain groups of people, dual language congregations, for instance. We have a Korean English congregation, Spanish English, that those congregations, that benchmark of saying you have to be self-sustaining in 3 years wasn't realistic. So there's all these people in their 20s, in certain neighborhoods in the city, like you can't be reached unless you're, we don't need a mission field for them unless they can be self-sustaining in 3 years. The new model is affiliated mission communities. So you have an incubator congregation, which is what we would be, that launches a new mission. So it provides a whole lot more protection, a whole lot more support, and we benefit directly. Emily and Matt Abrahamson were part of one of these congregations that's still going. And would you say they meet a need of people that otherwise there wouldn't be a congregation there?
Yeah, so we were a part of Holy Trinity in Chicago, and the congregation is based actually right by Wrigley Field. But they met a need in the South Loop, which was rapidly growing with condos and all sorts of things. And so it was an area that didn't have an ELCA congregation. And they're thriving. It's been since 2014.
Yeah. So did you all hear enough of that? So Holy Trinity, and that's actually where I did part of my seminary experience, but it was before they had launched a second site. So it's a much more supported model, but there is not just one model anymore. It's not like this is the way it goes, and then you're done. You have a lot more latitude, a lot more space to let a congregation develop. So the idea is, if you look at you've got the incubator congregation and you've got this other community out there and we're connected and there's feedback coming both ways. Both congregations will benefit. But if we vote to do this, and the goal is to vote on this in October to say yes, we're going forward, the Monday after that annual meeting, we will form a call committee and get to work on finding a mission developer, because it's a little bit of a needle in a haystack. Is this not true? So we will get busy finding a mission developer, and we will call a second pastor. And a lot of people are wondering, what's going to happen? Will you preach out there? Will they preach here? Yes. That's the gift, right? Is that we get to share some of the responsibilities back and forth between the two congregations. The other connections between it, how these congregations are connected, each incubator congregation has developed this in their own unique way, and we will too. And one of the things you'll hear Craig Dessens talk about is that we're going to form a team that's going to be focused on that. What kinds of benchmarks will we be looking for? How will we measure it? How often will we measure it? So we don't know exactly what it will look like, but we'll have a team of people working on that. Does that make a little bit of sense? So a much more supported model, all right? So we can all see that it's a mission field out there. We've got this much more supported model in our Synod. Why now? Well, why not now? Thank you, Jim. All right, so I was still totally with the Planning for Generosity team. I thought 2 to 4 years. You know what, first I need to say something about Elburn. The first Planning for Generosity meeting, which was in January of 2017, I have always thought that this affiliated mission community idea was really cool. But Craig Dessens, I think, at that meeting, I said, you know, if any church is gonna do mission in this valley, it's gonna be us. And then he said, you know, Elburn's growing, and I'm like, yeah, we don't do that anymore. That's how visionary I am. But you know, from that meeting on, I was like, oh. And I started having conversations with people. And one of the people that I happened to have conversations with, I talked to all of my colleagues around. So for those of you who are wondering, are all the other congregations gonna be in a panic? All their pastors know that this is happening. So I don't know how far it's gone into the congregations and if there's any anxiety about that, but all of them are fully aware that this is happening, and as far as I can tell, have given their blessing and their encouragement for it. But one of the people that I talked to said, I want to seed that with a $100,000 gift. Not for any other purpose. It can only be used for a mission start up there. So that obviously kind of moves things along a little bit in your head. But even without much of a vision that someone could see that, and I think there were 4 or 5 people here that could see the Elburn thing before I did, that gives affirmation that we might be moving in the right direction. So having other people see it, then I finally get the idea that, oh yeah, we could do this. And then to have someone see it enough to say, I want to be part of this and seed it. So it was my responsibility then to call the Synod office and say, hey, we have an offer of a gift to help us seed a congregation in Elburn. And Pastor Garfies came out, we drove around, we sat at the lunch place there, Brianna's on Route 38, and we're mapping it out. And in my head is, what's the time frame?
3 to 5 years.
3 to 5, and we're about a year in, so 2 to 4 years. And so he explained everything, how this works, and the Synod gives $96,000 total over 3 years to help support this mission, so $32,000 a year. And I said, so I'm thinking like 2 to 3 years. And I don't think he laughed at me, but I think he kind of wanted to. He's like, oh no. The Synod would like to see a proposal by April 2019. We'd like to have you get going by then. So if you're concerned about the why now question, you can talk to Vince, remember? But you know, this is the way things happen sometimes in our lives, right? Where you think you have a timeline, like this is how things are gonna unfold, this is how it's gonna be. And you get all kinds of signs. That's, I think, how the Holy Spirit works. It's like, hello, the time is now. Here's the bottom line. The only thing that I can really ever do as a pastor is draw stick figures, and that's for real. And the leadership team and the staff have been amazing in getting us to this point where we had something to tell you, where it was in some kind of organized format where we can paint a picture. Why Geneva Lutheran Church? Because it's part of our history, because it's who we are in our present, and we've been planning for it. Why this particular mission? Just drive out there and you'll see. Why now? Because some resources have come our way. Our Synod also is coming alongside us and saying, we agree. And I think Pastor Garfield said something like, in 3 or 4 years, there will be lots of other congregations that will be out there. So it won't just be us. But do you know who's gonna, we give you colored pencils and stuff so that you really can color it in, but the bottom line is, if anyone's gonna put flesh on these stick figures, it's gonna be all of you. I can't do this. Your leadership team can't do this. This is gonna take an act of all of us working together. So what you're gonna get to do now, because I can see the questions spinning around in your head. Do you feel like I answered the why GLC, why this mission, and why now? Okay, so what you're gonna do now is, you've got some post-its on your table, and I encourage you to actually talk to each other a little bit. Get up, get a bottle of water, a cup of coffee, get some sweets, get energized. You're gonna write down your questions, then we're gonna be organizing them, and Craig is gonna tell you kind of the next phases and how these things will go. So, get to work at your tables. Thank you.
And you're even an early morning person.
I am. I was like, you know what? I woke up like,
that's why.
Oh, are you sure you don't want a cookie?
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah,
no,
Elmer is going to
give one.
It's
so small.
And they're not quite happy. Yeah.